Today we'll talk about tumor properties of mammals' fat tissue, and main issues I would like to discuss are the following. Fat tissue of mammals are evolutionary novel organ which functions as one single entity. It is actually one new, so to say, definition in biology, though it exists for several years. This organ has several tumor signs which can assume that it's comes from hereditary mesenchymal tumors, and we can consider this as a tumor-like organs, and thus we can assume that obesity could be considered as part of the oncology issues and should be as so to be treated by oncologists. So we develop one new theory, biological oncological, which we call carcino evo devo, which comes to our great Russian scientists, Gary Abelev, who discovered carcinoembryonal antigens, and Alexei Severtsov, who is an evolutionary morphologist who opened EvoDevo. And we united both those directions, or theory or theory of evolutionary role of the tumors. The main hypothesis is that tumor, they provide space for expression of evolutionary new genes. And this hypothesis actually has several non-trivial, so to say, prognoses. We will later talk about genes. Andrey will talk, Andrey Makashev will talk about non-trivial forecasts, but we will analyze the following. If evolutionary new organs happens from tumors, they should have tumor signs. And yes, indeed. For instance, this is our old data. We discussed them several times. But look at the nice head. It's a nice organ of that fish, which selectionist selected. The signs of organs, it is symmetric, is located in the special place of this goldfish, and it develops a special stage of development, and the cancer sign that it grows without any, so to say, limits. And you see in some fish, it could grow that strong that this cap, you see, is a they swim, so to say, so they show that they swim in a, so say, upward manner, so to say, so head over the hills, if I may say so. So evolutionary young organs are placenta, breasts, and prostate. And placenta has so many tumor signs that the whole conferences were dedicated to that, and the issue is it, what's the difference of the placenta from the tumor? So now we start to talk, we say that it's just controllable or tumors, that's it, no more differences. Breast and prostate are the most tumor, keen tumor, so say, to organs to able to form majority tumors, and it's related to the evolutionary novelty of those organs. And we created such a table for evolutionary new organs that have lots of common signs, and we will look at this table later on.
And all of a sudden, it turns out, as I told you previously, the fatty organ of mammals is something that is a separately functioning organ, and there is a priority of this completely new paradigm, which belongs to Severo Sinti, an Italian professor, who is a director of obesity institution or R&D institution in Italy. So this organ is an anatomic structure that can be removed, which has certain type of tissue and certain functions. So this is a removed fatty tissue, which in fact includes a number of depots. You can see here that it can be subject to different temperature modifications, and it changes color. It happens because there are several types of tissues of different colors, starting from beige, adipose tissues, and then goes into completely brown, and it can be related to differentiation by brown. So the function of this adipose tissue, or adipose organ, is the regulation of central metabolism, and it regulates fundamental metabolic function in the mammals, and its central role is the energy metabolism and the metabolism of glucose. What is most interesting is that this is evolutionary new for mammals, despite the fact that the cells are quite old and there are old proteins, because lipids are quite old, but evolutionary this organ is more or less novel, because the brown tissue or beige adipose tissue in fact occur only in mammals, and gradually, so to say, they can depose it only in mammals, and you can see that from these charts. It was quite novel for us as well when we discovered that this is an evolutionary new organ. We started to look for tumor signs, and we discovered them, discovered quite many of them. And the first sign, in fact, was a huge expansion capacity, both for hypoplasia, and those people who dealt with adipose organ metabolism, they actually were reporting their discoveries about the fact that they resemble tissue tumor very much. And generally speaking, we can detect them in 40% of population, which is quite many. Then reversible plasticity. This is something that is very typical of this type of adipose tissue. A lot of reviews were devoted to this. I'd like to say that adipose tissue, in fact, are quite plastic, and this plasticity is quite immense. It can be related to temperature modification, physical exercise, lactation, obesity. You will see plasticity, and it is related to transdifferentiation. I should say that this picture shows exactly this color modification, which in fact is related to transdifferentiation of the white adipose tissue into the beige and brown. More to that, we see a certain breast plasticity when adipocytes are transdifferentiated into mammary epithelial cells. And by themselves, they can originate from the cancerous cells of the breast in vitro, which is a magic property by itself, and I would like to say that it's very interesting. And also angiogenesis induction and tumor growth induces angiogenesis, and I would like to say that it depends mainly on hypoxia. Also, hypoxia can result in chronic inflammation because macrophage migrate. And as a matter of fact, the fatty acids also take part, and there is a loop that is the basis of chronic inflammation process, both in adipose tissue and adipose organ and in the tumor cells and tumor tissue, similar mechanism behind it. Both obesity and tumor processes are chronic inflammatory processes from this viewpoint. Then remodeling and defunction. Chronic inflammation results in a number of changes in the structure and function of adipose tissue, as well as the loss of fatty tissue function as such. And the same we can actually recognize in the tumor tissue. Both the organ and the fat tissue, they influence the system, as the adipose tissue is the central regulator of an energy metabolism. All the impairments within this metabolism can result in systemic problems. And also, the part of such systemic influence is the hormone production. As people usually say, even those who don't know much about adipose tissue, they consider the adipose tissue to be an endocrine organ, actually understanding that it's some central regulation organ. They produce adipocytes, which are hormones produced by adipose tissue, and classical cytokines such as TNF-5 and TNF-alpha, excuse me. And one of the hormones, adiptine, is a central regulator of energy metabolism. Also, we can say pretty much the same about the tumor. there are a great number of tumors of different production. They produce hormones, the so-called ectopic synthesis, which are not typical of the tumors where there is no production of such. Then microRNA, also influencing other tissues, also produces both adipose tissue and tumors. They can result in immune suppression. This is Ivan Dilman, who worked in R&D institution named after Petrov, and he actually is the co-founder of the metabolic immune suppression principle. It is well known that obesity, as well as the metabolic syndrome, they can result in immune suppression. The same happens here. I have already mentioned inflammatory processes and oxidative stress. They result in the destruction of DNA, and they must result in apoptosis, but for some reason they don't. Why not? As a matter of fact, adipose tissue produces apoptose inhibitors, and this is the property of DNA impairment or destruction, which is very typical of processes within adipose tissue. Also, actin reduxate is something that takes part in the metabolic syndrome and also in the tumor formation. And also a very general and dramatic sign common for the tumor and obesity. This is ectopic deposition of fat, which happens in the skeletal muscles, in the liver, in the heart, as well as in the kidneys during the development of obesity. It is related to infiltration with adipocytes. This is a bright example of metastasis. It's metastatic process. It's very similar to what happens in the tumor process, and it actually destroys the function of those organs where metastasis happen, and they actually impair the same signal pathways that would be impaired in the tumor growth process. Also, melanin can be used both for cancer treatment as well as obesity treatment. Professor Anisimov and Professor Burstein, they actually did a lot in this particular direction, using biguanides, for instance, continuing the teachings of Dilman. This particular slide shows summary. These are the overall overall list of functions of adipose tissue. There are 14 bullet points all in all, and this particular features is not something that I put here by chance, because they cover the whole list of hallmarks of cancer. These are the main hallmarks of cancer, the main signs of cancer. You can see that obesity and tumor genesis, they can be characterized with a full list of common features. Thus, we can say that obesity is very similar to tumor process, and most probably that means that our duty, our coverage of oncologists can be expanded to it. And also, we can trace the adipose tissue origin. According to the theory of evolution, we can think that the adipose tissue is actually a result of some benign mesenchymal tumor, which produced some active substances which grew into hormones, and it learned how to synthesize fat. And as a matter of fact, evolutionary-wise, it started impairing the function of central regulation in the conditions of ever-changing nutrients and nutrition elements. And not very long ago, we received verification of this theory, because we took a model of transgene tumor in fish. Now here, you can see a flow diagram, which is the result of such gene comparison. And as a matter of fact, we received the following. The genes which activate and which work in the tumors of the fish. Evolutionary new genes that are active in these tumors, they also can be can have human autolog. As a matter of fact, it's a progressive function, and we characterize 23 genes of this kind. You can see leptin, which I talked about, which is the central regulator of fat metabolism, of energy metabolism. And this is part of this set of genes. As a matter of fact, we discovered 5 genes out of 23 at the moment, which take part in the adipose organ function in mammals. More to that, they also take part in the tumor development process in mammals, and also they interact with one another. They either inhibit one another or activate. So we have an example of new regulatory network which appeared in fish and which actually function in mammals as well, in adipose and tumor tissue. And now let's think back to the tumor plasticity, to the cell plasticity, which I already talked about. Experimentally, we discovered and demonstrated that adipocytes can actually originate from the malignant cells of breast cancer. So as a matter of fact, you have this loop closed. Our adipose fat most probably can be the result of some benign tumor process. So in the beginning, I showed you, I demonstrated to you this chart, which showed the tumor-like organs. All of them can be also adjusted to the adipose organ. Now, we can come to the conclusion. The first one is that the adipose organ in mammals can be attributed to the tumor-like organs, just like placenta, breast, and prostate. The presence of such organ is a verification of one of the prediction theories showing that evolutionary young organs are associated with the tumor signs. Most probably this means expansion of the role of oncology and taking into account the processes related to obesity. And another huge summary or conclusion is that the presence of such signs of tumor in adipose tissue envisage the fact that we can utilize approaches such as low calorie intake, keto diet in tumor treatment, even if there is no obesity, and vice versa. Some medicines and interventions in early tumor treatment can also be used in obesity treatment. And this means that we have new horizons open up. And this is what is happening. This is a review of 2021, April. In fact, this is a relatively new publication. A classical oncology looks at diet as some sort of alternative medicine. But generally speaking, it grows into completely regular approach. You can see 3 clinical trials which are ongoing in the United States at the moment in different types of cancers with the use of different diets and different nutrition approaches. The outcome is to show that such type of intervention can improve outcomes of pharmacotreatment. I suppose that we should not be lagging behind, and we should initiate a similar study in order to be in the forefront of medicine and not to catch up later. We are in discussion with oncologists at the moment because we think that it's much cheaper than actually trials for new drugs and medicines, because dietary interventions are well known. We do have experience, and we have certain bodies and organizations that deal with that. The only thing that we need is just some effort. I'm very grateful to the Evolutionary School of St. Petersburg University, then R&D institution named after Petrov, a National Cancer Institute, as well as the Biomedicine Institution of General Genetics, as well as the Polytechnical University named after Peter the Great. Thank you.